loud or you can't hear me enough. Sorry, I've got the coach voice going, so my apologies. As I said, what a great time to be part of the Magnolia Panther football program. And it is always a highlight for our program, for us and for me personally, to get the opportunity to come here to speak with you. And it gives me the opportunity to brag on our kids on the things that we've accomplished so far this year. It seems like just a week ago that we made it to the playoffs for the first time since, I think it was 2010. So there's a lot of excitement going on in our program right now. We started on July 31st, so kids had a great summer. I'll talk about that in a minute. But it was good to get back into the rhythm and back into school, believe it or not, get them on a normal routine. And we're excited about this football season coming up. There's so much that goes into the development of a football program that goes on behind the scenes that nobody knows about. And that begins with our administration. So I would like to say a personal thank you to Mr. Ward, Coach Lindsay, for all the personal support that they've given me and given us as a program, because without them, then our kids don't get the opportunity that they have to put the best product on the field that we can. I'd also like to take a moment to thank our quarterback club, because, as you know, we had our state fundraiser last Monday night, and Joe Peratt is our president, Kerry Roach is our vice president, and Nancy Lewis is our treasurer. And without their unbelievable efforts, we wouldn't have had the chance to provide the things that we need to do for our kids, because there's more to it than just the football part of it. There's the education. There's making sure that they have the things that they need. And because we're out to develop the entire person, the entire program, there's a rejuvenated spirit, not only in our program, in our school, in our town, and that goes with being part of a great football program. And our kids see that. They thrive on it. They feed off of it. And it makes them where they are ready to come to work every single day. And that's one of the things that we ask them to do. We ask them to develop the work ethic, so that when they come to work and it's that time of day, that forget everything else for that 2.5-3 hour block, and let's go to focusing on football. And before that ever starts, you've got to take care of things in the classroom. You've got to take care of things at home. And that's our number one goal, is to develop great people. As you can see, and I hear it around town all the time, everybody's excited about football season. When do we start? When's the first game? We'll go to Walmart. And that's one of the best things that happens, at least in my household, is when we go to Walmart, we get in the car, and my two kids ask me, does everybody always have to talk about football? Yeah, they do. I want our entire town to be eaten up with Panther football, because that tells me we're doing something right. When people are coming up to us, and it's not just myself, it's the assistant coaches, it's the players. They want to know what's going on. How are you guys doing in the weight room? How are you taking care of things on the field? What's your schedule like? Who's your toughest opponent? Those are great things to us, because that means that everybody is starting to bleed Panther red. And those are the things that we need. Because when it comes on a Friday night, we want to look up in the stands, and we don't want to see empty seats. We want to see those seats as full as they can, people up yelling and screaming, because it's an entertainment. We're not here to put things just out on the field. We're here to entertain them, the fans in the stadium, the fans that are not there, they can hear it. We want that to be as loud as it can possibly be. So for everybody to talk about Magnolia football, those are great things to us. Now, the hallmark of our program and our number one goal is to develop great people. Because if we don't have great people, the football side of it's going to end. That's one of the first statements that we make. Unless they go and do what I'm doing and what the other coaches are doing, then the opportunities for them to ever make a dime playing the game of football is almost nothing. So your education is the first thing. And we stress that constantly. And every semester, I calculate our grades. And we keep up with those as we go for progress. This semester, Fester, I saw something that in 22 years of coaching, I had never seen before. At the end of the first semester, or excuse me, the second semester in the spring, I started calculating our GPAs for eligibility. And I did the number of classes, and obviously the football does not count because that's not the academic class. So when you looked at all of our players, there were 402 classes that were taken out of all of our players. Out of those 402, 400 of those classes were passed with a, some of them had a D, but 400 out of 402 classes were passed. That is 99.5%. So that tells me that the message is getting through and our kids are taking care of the classroom. Because if we can have a 99.5% passage rate, that means we're going to graduate our players. And our main goal is there are two places we want them to go. We want them to either go to college or we want them to come to you needing a job. Because we want them here in our workforce. And that goes back to the hallmark of our program. We're going to develop great people that are going to produce in this society. And a lot of them are going to do it here. And the way to do that is to develop a work ethic and a drive so that when it comes time to come to you for a job, now you've got a great employee. And that's the biggest compliment I get from people around town is, I sure love having your kids when they come to work for us. I mean, that's what it is. We're trying to develop them not only on the football field, but prepare them for life. When I went back and looked at our total GPA, our team goal, it's hard to develop it, it's hard to achieve it, and I said it at a level, when you're talking about over 70 kids, our goal is to have a 3.0 GPA. We almost got there. We're a little bit short. Our team GPA was 2.83. That raised it 0.2 of a point from the previous semester. So our kids are doing a really good job of letting the message sink in because they have to take care of the classroom first. Without that, then nothing else matters. The other side of that is, if they can't think, 85% of this game is played from the neck up. You can do all the physical tools you want, but you have to be able to think in order to play because you've got to see it and react to it. So we're trying to develop the brain as well as their physical tools. And again, I talked about the goal of our program, and you keep hearing me say the same things over and over. That's kind of our point. It's the consistency of our message. We're going to develop men of character with great work ethic because we want them to eventually become great fathers because our society needs that. Now, there are things that you're not always going to see out on the field. And one of the things that we watch for is we make adjustments. Things are not going to happen the way you want them to. Hurricane Harvey coming through has caused great changes to happen to everybody all over the world. What do you do with it? And that's kind of what we push our kids to do. Every Friday night you're going to see something that happens that you weren't expecting. Be able to change it on the fly. Be able to move and do things according to what you're seeing and make those adjustments on the sideline. Our coaches, I get great compliments about that, is when a series is over, our coaches come to the sideline, they're around the players, and we're drawing like crazy because we're figuring out we're not always going to get the same look every time. They're going to give us something, especially with our offense now. We're going to get a new wrinkle. They're going to come out in something defensively that we have never seen before. How do you change it? How do you adapt to it? There's another life lesson. That's the biggest thing that gets missed is there's so many life lessons in what we do with this game because it's not always about going out and playing the game. It's about being able to make your adjustments to what's in front of you in life. The other thing that we focus on is you have a job to do. Don't worry about anything else. You have a job to do. And you have a team. It is a team development game. And you have to be able to do your job because the person next to you is Reedside Elementary. It was July. It was late July, and they were moving teachers from classroom to classroom for health help group. So those teachers were going to have to move all the stuff, move furniture. They couldn't do it. She called me and said, can you give me some help? We had 12 kids that dropped everything, went over, and spent the entire day moving teachers from classroom to classroom because they needed it. You do what has to be done. And that goes back to our kids are willing to do what's right. That's all we ask them to do, do what's right. That makes practice fun. Because when you have that, when you have kids that are going to come in and they're going to do whatever you ask them to do, and again, not all the time. There's going to be times where we have to get on them. But that's the nature of being a kid. But most of the time, we have unbelievable kids that are willing to do what we ask them to do. That's why at 2:25, that's the best part of my day. Because I'm waiting for them at the gate. And I watch them coming down that ramp. And they are ready to go. There's a smile on their face. We greet them. We hug them. And we get going. And they're ready to go to practice. It's taken a while. But we're finally getting there. Now, most of what you've heard hasn't been football. Because I'm not talking about the football side of it. We're here to develop great people. Now, I know you're ready to talk football, aren't you? Kind of stole my thunder here a little bit. But we made the playoffs last year for the first time in a while. Are you satisfied? Is that good enough? The coach and me? No, that's never good enough. It's not good enough until we put the ring on our finger. And even then, it's still not good enough. Because I want another degree like that. But I want the best for our kids because I love seeing the smile on their face when they come down that ramp. Because when you're successful, when you know what the goal is, when you can achieve it, when you can work for it, and you have that tangible evidence of what you're trying to accomplish, and you get it done, it makes things a whole lot better. Our weight room has been the biggest payoff to our success. We test everything on three lifts, and we have a 1,000-pound club. We're going to test bench, we're going to test squat, we're going to test power plant. And if you can get 1,000 pounds on those three lifts, then that tells me you're doing something right with weight room. Right now, our goal has been about where it's stayed consistently. We have seven members of that club right now. I'd like about 15 to 20. But that comes through perpetual work and being ready to go to work in the summer. Our summer weight participation, it was at an all-time high this year. Happens when you win it. Happens when you stick with it. So we get a lot of things done. We had two team camps. We worked in Nashville, and we worked here with our team camp. Team camp is, we have seven teams that were here. And it is, if you've never been to one of our team camps, we have it the second Tuesday in June. I encourage you to come out and watch it because it is a giant ant farm. We have kids that are going all over the place, and it is structured chaos, and they know where they're going. It's not just our kids. It's kids from other schools. But we line up, and we get after it. In addition to team camps, we did two 7-on-7s. Obviously, when you're running the flex bone, throwing the ball is not your specialty. We're going to do that. We do that mainly to get our defense work. You really don't know because we're going off cards and running option stuff to go out and run passing plays. So you really don't know what to expect. But the first one didn't go very well when we went to Camden. When we went to El Dorado, lo and behold, we look up and we're in the quarterfinals. So they've adjusted. Defensively, we played well. Our junior high went to 7-on-7 this summer in El Dorado, and lo and behold, they won the thing. So there's great success coming. Our junior high the last 2 years have had great success. We won the junior high conference 2 years in a row. Let's make it three. Our staff has had some changes to it. Coach Sisson retired at the junior high. John Rich, who many of you know, has moved to the junior high head coach. I sent one of our high school assistants down to be the defensive coordinator. We have three new assistants at the high school. Some of you may know some of these names. Rashad Sims is coaching the corners. Curtis Shannon is coming to us coaching our running backs. And then Lance Castleman, some of you may know him. He was a four-year starter out here at SAU. He is coaching our offensive line. So if you see new faces down the sideline, that's who those people are. Offensively, we're doing the exact same thing. We're staying FlexBone. That is installed from seventh grade up. They need that consistency. And obviously, last year didn't start very well, but as it went on, we put the switch. And I've never had that where you go 1-4 and then you flip it completely around and go 4-1. But that comes from consistency and taking care of the ball. Coach LaValle and the offensive staff did a great job of staying the course, don't panic, and let's worry about what we do. And here we go. Next step in the process. We had jamborees, which are scrimmages. High school scrimmaged Hamburg. And that ended in a 7-3, I guess you could say, defeat to Hamburg. We had the ball inside the 10 twice. We just need to find a way to punch it in and score. Defensively, they hit us on a couple of trick plays. But, at the same time, breaking in 9 new starters, we're in good shape for where we are, where we need to be at this point. Tonight, El Dorado, the junior high, again, is at El Dorado. They start at 5:30 with the 8th grade. The ninth grade will follow, and then you have us playing tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We encourage you all to come out and, again, want it as loud as possible. So come out and have a good time, and hopefully we'll put on a good show for you. Questions? Yes,
sir. Coach, this may be Coach Lindsay, too. I'm confused about classifications all the time. What are we looking at as far as
this year
and next year?
This year we're going to be the same thing. In football, it's not going to change. And the rest of the sports, starting next year, we'll go down to the 4A classification. And that'll be for a 2-year cycle. We don't know which conferences we will be in. We don't know if they'll send us east or if they'll send us west. We won't find that out for another couple of weeks. And like I say, that'll be a 2-year cycle. And I truly think that after that 2 years, something else will happen, because it was only one vote to change this. And so I think it'll change again after that. But we won't know anything more about that for another couple of weeks.
Yes,
sir. Coach, who do you expect to be your toughest competition this year in the conference?
Our conference is loaded with talent. Watson Chapel's going to be really talented. Lakeside has a lot returning. I know they lost the other night when they played Pulaski Robinson, but they'll be talented. Camden's going to be very athletic. So it's top to bottom, it's going to be a tough challenge every week. We just have to make sure we show up and play. Yes, sir?
Can you tell us about what's going on with the facilities?
We are excited to move into our new facility. If you've driven by the high school, there is a new weight room / cheer room that is being constructed, and I'm not sure what year was that other one built.
Back in
82?
Yeah, it was about
80, 81. So I've got drawings of it, and the kids have seen it, and the day I pulled out the drawing, the kids were literally, they were jumping up and down because it's a long time coming, and that is going to be a first-class facility, not only for football, for the cheer room as well. So it's a great thing. What is the date on that? October 16th?
October 19th.
So that will be when it is complete.
Coach, what kind of new rules do you have that AAA's put on you that fans and staff can appreciate?
That's something that's, forever they've talked about defending or hitting the defenseless player. The biggest rule that they have, for example, we had one last year in the Hope game where they threw an out route and we had a corner that was sitting there waiting on it, and he hit it. They didn't eject it, but they could have. They're trying to eliminate the head injuries. They're trying to eliminate them going high. So and they've always called that on the defender. They have now expanded that, and they are calling it blindside block rule, which is the old crack block. They're trying to take that out of the game. So if you have a receiver that is coming outside in to try to block a linebacker, and they're trying to eliminate the ear hole shots. And so the way you have to approach it is we teach our kids to what I call come to balance. So they're going to come inside, and then they have to break down and wait for that defender to turn and then block him with open hands. So it's going to be interesting to see how they call that. It's not an ejection right now. It could be. But that's the major one. They've also changed the onside rule. You can no longer, the NFL does it where they drive the ball into the ground and it takes that huge hop. They're eliminating that because too many people were sitting there waiting on the ball and they get blasted. So every change that they make is in the name of player safety, and those are the two major ones. Yes, sir?
There's going to be the player to watch this year.
Lots of them. You know when you can answer like that, Loman. We've got a lot of returners coming back. Peyton Campbell started for us at safety last year as a sophomore. He is our starting quarterback. Obviously, Caden Roach had a great sophomore season. We look for big things from him. And again, our main objective is to create more explosive plays. We want to be a high octane offense, so that can score at the drop of a hat. So, we have a young kid that moved in from Hampton that is very explosive. So, we'll see him come on. It'll be interesting to see who answers when the lights come on. Yes, sir.
How big is the offensive line?
Not very. Which is why we went to this offense, because if you've ever watched Navy play, they're not very big compared to their opponent. And this offense is about getting off the football and what we call rocking the head. And because all you have to do is get in their face for about a count. And then by that time, everything else is gone. Because it's happening quick. So we're not very big up front. Yes, sir?
Is there any plans to turf the field and all that sort of stuff?
About the first week that I was on the job, I was out on the football field. Do you remember what I asked you?
You asked me point blank if I could have my option between turf or a first-class weight room, which one would I have? And I didn't even blink. I said a weight room because we have no bumper plates. We have nothing to develop our kids. We play a game on that field 5 times a year. Well, obviously not with the junior high, but the varsity plays on that game field 5 times a year. So it means more to our program and our kids as far as their health, their strength, and everything to have that weight room. So without even batting an eye, he didn't even finish it. I said, I need a weight room. Right. We have a place we can practice. Matter of fact, we split our practice yesterday. With the rain, I said, if we're going outside, and they all looked at me like I had grown a third eyeball because we had the indoor, but we needed to handle the wet ball.